Yahweh, your God, is in your midst, a warrior bringing victory. He will create calm with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Welcome to this service of worship. We're glad that you're with us. We have a few things that we want to note for you as we continue together. First, we are in Advent. And Advent marks the beginning of our journey through scriptures, through the scriptures of the life of Christ and of God's life with God's people. And so it's also a season of anticipation and dreams of Christ's coming. And so this year, our theme for Advent is close to home. And we'll explore this in all kinds of ways. So be sure to keep up with your devotion booklet and Advent calendar. Now, this week, as a part of the traditional Advent themes, we're going to be looking at joy. And so joy is something, well, let me just ask you, is it something that happens to you, or is it a way that you choose to respond? And as you define joy for yourself, in what ways will you bring joy to someone else this week? Also, we want to note for you that our Christmas Eve services, our Christmas Eve candlelight services, will be in person and online this year, with the later service, the 11:15 service, being live streamed. The early service will be at 5:30 p.m. And again, the later service will be at 11:15. If you have any interest in helping with the liturgy, setting up, cleaning up, or with the live streaming technicalities, please do let me know as soon as possible, and be sure to tell people about the services themselves. With all of that in mind, let us take a deep breath, silence our devices, and continue in worship. Joy is seeing people you love after months apart. Joy is hearing, "Come on over, it has been too long." Joy is the stretches and giggles of a newborn child. Joy is making it home when the journey is long. Joy is your dog sliding to meet you at the door. Joy is the energy of a new season. Joy is feeling found when you thought you were lost. So today, we light the candle of joy, because the welcome God has for us is nothing short of joyful. Rest in that good news. Let it wash over you. Family of faith, we are close to home. Amen.
The greatest day. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He is alive. Earthly pain finally will see. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day, you washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
You know, it takes courage to tell the truth. John the Baptist knew it. His job as a prophet certainly could not have been easy. And you and I know it. Our job as people of faith to create a home for all has never been easy. And in our prayer of confession, in our prayer of preparation, we may channel some of John the Baptist's courage to tell the truth about ourselves and our world. We do not do this to shame ourselves or guilt ourselves for being imperfect. Not at all. We speak the truth out loud because we know that we cannot grow and change without first being honest. So let us be brave. Let us be bold. Let us be truth tellers as we confess together now to a God who couldn't love us any more than God already does. Let us pray together. Expansive God, we know that the church is your house, and your house has room for everyone. Yet, too often, instead of setting the table for our neighbors, we block the door. Instead of welcoming all, we judge others by our own standards. Instead of sharing our second coat, we hide it in the attic, holding on to fear instead of letting go with love. Remind us that your home is a home for all. That truth requires hard work. That truth requires uncomfortable justice. Help us to be bold enough to see it and brave enough to live it. With hope we pray. Amen. Thank you for listening, God. Amen. You know, it can be hard to accept, some person, even God, telling us to have joy when we clearly are in the middle of trouble or strife. In some ways, it can even sound crass or grotesque. Take this prophecy from Zechariah. This is chapter 3, verses 14 through 18. Rejoice, daughter Zion, shout, Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, daughter Jerusalem. Yahweh has removed your judgment. He has turned away your enemy. Yahweh, the King of Israel, is in your midst. You will no longer fear evil. On that day it will be said to Jerusalem, "Don't fear Zion. Don't let your hands fall." Here you have God commanding God's people to rejoice, even though they've lost their homes, their livelihoods, their families, even their lives, and it is not at all clear or guaranteed that any of it is coming back. The exile has taken its toll on the people, and this promise of God of restoration can sound quite hollow. But what does God mean when commanding them to rejoice? I mean, is God really saying, throw a party about all the troubles? No. Not really, no. In fact, God is telling them the same thing that God has been saying to them ever since the Garden of Eden. Trust me and do as I say. Specifically, love God with all your heart and with all your mind and all your soul and all your strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. This is the way home. This is the pathway to end the exile. This is the road to real restoration. But we don't always buy that. When we think about our own Christian walks, we tend to be transactional about it. Well, I'm saved, so I've got heaven in store for me, blessings in store for me, God's grace and forgiveness given to me. And look, great, all of that is so. But not only that, I also get for all of that for the bargain, I get all of that for the bargain price of accepting Jesus as my personal Savior. God is good, right? But that analysis always seems to leave out the part that God and the prophets always include. That way of looking at our faith fails to acknowledge that salvation, restoration, is not a transaction. It's a transformation. I mean, one of the major problems with the prosperity gospel, okay, the idea that if you're in with God, then you're rich. That's how it goes. And it turns the promises of God into something perverse, even fleeting. God doesn't save us in order to play favorites. There's a far-reaching purpose to God's grace with us. And it isn't simply to play tricks with our troubles. God is trying to address something far more fundamental. God isn't just trying to save us from destruction. God is trying to make us right. And the way God is trying to do that is to make us responsible. You know, it can be easy to read the tail end of this passage that we're reading from Zephaniah and fall into the mental trap of thinking that it's about God making all of us rich again. God says, "Watch what I'm about to do to all your oppressors at that time. I will deliver the lame. I will gather the outcast. I will change their shame into praise and fame throughout the earth. At that time, I will bring all of you back. At that time, at the time when I gather you, I will give you fame and praise among all the neighboring peoples when I restore your possessions and you can see them," says Yahweh. I mean, doesn't that at least sound like God cares that we lost everything and that the way to glory is for us to get it all back? Good times. But if that was all there was to it, then that's a pretty lame promise when you get right down to it. I mean, wealth comes and goes. Even cherished friends come and go. Health comes and goes. Loved ones come and go. What God is talking about is something that lasts. I mean, remember, any promise of God, any promise, needs to be rooted in the promise of God, the one that was made to Abraham. The one that includes all of us. You can't see any of the other promises, including the ones in the New Testament, in any other proper context. God blesses Abraham so that he will be a blessing to everyone around him. God blesses the Israelites, even in exile, so that they will be a blessing, even to the occupying forces. God blesses us so that we will be a blessing. It's not just about us having stuff. It's about God having God's way with everyone. The language God uses is always the language of transformation, not transaction. That's part of what's wrong with the way that we celebrate Christmas nowadays. It's totally become a transactional kind of deal. Did you get me a present? Not am I actually being a present? I mean, from lame to delivered, from outcast to gathered, from shame to fame, from exile to home. This is what God is trying to do. That's what it means for God's favor to transform us. And that means that God's favor with us has strings. Let's be clear. God's grace with us can't be bought. Okay, God's sole agenda with us is love. God's salvation is bought and paid for by Christ. There is no return policy or backseas or trick plays. God offers grace to us, period. Okay? But it is foolishness on our part to think that God saves us and then that's the end of the story. I mean, that's like being in shark-infested waters with 30 other people and being the first one drawn into the lifeboat and then saying, well, great job, you all. Thanks for saving me. Let's go home. What about the other 29 people? And given that you're now in the boat, shouldn't you be about the business of reaching into the waters and pulling more people onto the lifeboat with you? You didn't plan for it, but you needed it. And you may not have even deserved the help, but you got it. What makes us more worthy because we are here than folks who are not here? Part of the fellowship of God's people. This is where real prosperity, the real prosperity, the real joy of the gospel takes place. This is where your faith, the purpose of God's saving you, comes into view. This is where faith gets real. When John the Baptist ministered in the wilderness, he got real, as they say. The crowds asked him, what then should we do? He answered, whoever has two shirts must share with the one who has none, and whoever has food must do the same. Even tax collectors came to be baptized. They said to him, teacher, what should we do? He replied, collect no more than you are authorized to collect. Soldiers asked, what about us? What should we do? He answered, well, don't cheat or harass anyone, and be satisfied with your pay. The people were filled with expectation, and everyone wondered whether John might be the Christ. John replied to them all, I baptize you with water, but the one who is coming is more, but the one who is more powerful than me is coming. I'm not worthy to loosen the strap of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. The shovel he uses to sift the wheat from the husks is in his hands. He will clean out his threshing area and bring the wheat into his barn, but he will burn the husks with a fire that can't be put out. With many other words, John appealed to them, proclaiming good news to the people. So says Luke chapter 3, verses 10 through 18. I mean, John name-called. He berated folks. He talked the same way to priests, soldiers, tax collectors, mothers, brothers. It didn't matter. He had a job to do, and that job was to get people ready for the coming of the Messiah. I mean, ever since his mom, Elizabeth, and his dad, Zechariah, started raising him, he was being prepared for the preparation work that he'd be doing, baptism for the forgiveness of sins. But, y'all, how is that preparing for the arrival of the Messiah? I mean, shouldn't he have been gathering armies and training them to fight against the Romans? Shouldn't he have been prepping them with the most violent parts of Scripture so that he could whip them into a holy rage? Shouldn't John have prepared everyone in secret so that the Romans never saw it coming? I mean, shouldn't John have played on their longings to have their stuff back, to have their loved ones back, to have their lives back? Shouldn't he have reminded them of everything that they could have once that they could have once Israel returned to true political and military power and dominance? Sure, if the Messiah he was serving was transactional, if the goal was prosperity for just a chosen few, I mean, that's one of the issues happening in Israel and the occupied territories right now. You have generations of families, of people fighting over who should possess the land. And it never occurred to God's own people that they should be sharing the land on God's terms, not theirs. We are content when God's promises reinforce our notions of wealth and security. We are good with a God who makes sure that we have the best of everything. We are quite happy with a God who covers our sins and lets us slide. But we fall short of the complete vision of what God is doing when we fail to see that everybody else is supposed to be benefiting from this also. Benefiting from God's grace. John tells the people plainly to show that they have been forgiven, that they have been transformed by none other than God, that they have done a 180-degree turn. I mean, properly, to repent means to turn around and to head in the opposite direction. That's what makes his advice so easy to follow. Share. No corruption. Be honest. Don't bully. I mean, can you imagine such a world? Can you imagine what it would be like if our leaders actually practice this? Can you imagine if we actually practice this out loud? Well, God can. And there's a pattern here for us to follow. There is an example. So then with endurance, let's also run the race that is laid out in front of us, since we have such a great cloud of witnesses surrounding us. Let's throw off any extra baggage, get rid of the sin that trips us up, repentance, and fix our eyes on Jesus, faith's pioneer and perfecter. He endured the cross, ignoring the shame for the sake of the, get this, joy that was laid out in front of him, and sat down at the right side of God's throne. God doesn't just save us so that we'll have warm, fuzzy feelings about God. God doesn't bless us because God wants to be friends with us on Facebook or be liked on all the posts that God sends to us. God's not trying to get higher in search rankings on Google or to become more popular. God doesn't need those things. In fact, God acknowledges the shame of the cross. God acknowledges our exile. God acknowledges our pains and mistakes and mishaps. God sees our messes and confronts them, not carpets over them. God deals with us as we are in the hopes of what we might be. God is seeking to transform us in order to transform the world. That's why the Messiah is coming. That's what John is preparing us for. And that, my dear brothers and sisters, is the joy of the gospel. God wants all of us home. You can hear it in the parables of the lost in Luke 15. In each story, Jesus ends the story with a frank invitation and plea. God, I hope that we hear it. Celebrate with me, for what is lost has been found. The lost sheep, the lost coin, the lost son. Celebrate. God wants us all to love God and to express that by loving our neighbor. God wants us all to be blessed and to be restored. God wants us all to be in this family of God and to find a place in God's mercy. That's why sharing is a sign of the gospel. That's why honesty is a sign of the gospel. That's why an end to corruption and selfishness is a sign of the gospel. That's why being my brother's and sister's keeper is a sign that not only is God real, but God's love has been made real in me. And no, I can't live your life for you. I'm not responsible for your sins. But I am responsible by virtue of my own salvation to reach into the waters and to pull you into the boat with me. We are responsible by virtue of the joy laid out before us to truly open the doors of our church and see to it that all are made to know that they are welcome. God's blessings can't stop with us. They must flow through us. Because home is a path, a way for us to live into the joy God wants for us all. Y'all, may we be the doors and windows and rooms and tables. Amen. people ask John, what should we do? I've asked myself that a million times in my life. How do I make a difference? Can I really do anything that could help this hurting world? Is it already too late? Is it already too big? It can feel overwhelming at times, but John says, if you have two coats, give one away. It's all that easy, and it's all that hard. So friends, let us give our tithes and our offerings and our time now or during the week or in the months to come, knowing that these gifts help build a world where we all have a home, where all are welcome, fed, loved, and known. What should we do? We should give what we have. It's all that easy and all that hard.
I am God's child. I am God's child. In my heart, I know God puts wisdom, a hope, and a prayer to see my family. In faces all around me, more cousins, more sisters, more fathers, more room, more brothers, more mothers, more room, more grannies, more pas, more uncles, more aunts, more people in the house, more room. I am God's child. I am God's child. In my heart, I am God's child. I am God's child. In my heart, I am God's child. And a prayer. I am God's child. In my heart, I am God's child. In my heart, I am God's child. In my heart, I am God's child. More brothers, more mothers, more room. In faces, I am God's child. More hands, more people in the house, more room. More cousins, more sons, more fathers, more brothers, more mothers, the prayer. More grannies, more pies, God's child. More aunts, more people in the house, more room. In faces, I am God's child. More cousins, more God's child. More brothers, more mothers, more room. In faces, I am God's child. More people in the house, more prayer. More cousins, more sisters, more fathers, more room. More brothers, more mothers, more room. More grannies, more pies, more uncles, more aunts, more people in the house, more room. More cousins, more sisters, more fathers, more room. More brothers, more mothers, more room. More grannies, more pies, more uncles, more aunts, more people in the house, more room.
Let us pray together. God, who welcomes us home, who creates space, who leaves a chair with our name on it, we have two coats, and we are giving one away. That's what this offering is. It's our second coat. It's our hearts on our sleeves. It's our audacious hope that there can indeed be a better world than this one. So take these gifts and use them to move us closer to that promised day. Gratefully, we pray. Amen. So the Lord be with you and also with you. Let us pray together. Lord God, we give you thanks. Thanks for another day. Thanks for another night. Thanks for another opportunity to at least see where you are at work in the world and to get some glimpse of where you might be at work in us. Help us to make room in our own awareness of your Spirit transforming us, not just for the sake of change, not just for the sake of making us rich, but that the world might be rich with your love, with your grace, and with your mercies. Help us to realize anew how much we have counted on your grace throughout our own lives. And as we think of that lifeboat, help us to consider reaching into the waters for others. This, Lord, is one of the reasons why we lift up our prayer list to you. We don't do it because we expect you to do everything and for us to do nothing. But we do lift it up to you in order to share your own awareness of all of these things and then to open ourselves to your direction for what we must do. Help us to hear your voice, to see your wisdom in our own voices, in our own actions, in our own ways of being your hands and feet, your ears, your mouth, your eyes in this world. Help us to really be conduits of your blessings, that we might fulfill the promise that you made to us so long ago. And we pray this, O God, especially in the face of the pandemic. Please bring it to an end and help us to do our part in making that so. Lord God, we ask you to continue this work of reconciliation and reckoning within our country, especially with our history and its plain results. Help us, O God, to do our part with that as well. Lord, we look at our own congregation and we look at the challenges before it, the seasons of loss, the seasons of health diminishing, the seasons, though, also of celebration and of goodness. In the midst of all of these things, O God, help us to be present and doing what you lead us to do. Now, O God, as we rapidly approach the end of the year, and as we approach the milestone of Christmas, and anticipate days of celebrating, hopefully, help us to be mindful of our blessings and to set fire in us that desire to be blessings ourselves. Help us in the midst even of our weariness and grief to reach past ourselves and see what you see in us, pathways to bring other people home as well. And so, God, thank you for contending with us, for not giving up on us, for teaching us even how to pray as you led us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us say together our benediction. Home is a path, a way for us to live into the joy God wants for all. May we all be doors and windows and rooms. Amen. Get up, take heart. Jesus is still calling you. Go in peace. Go in joy. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee.